Good morning. I think we'll get started. My name is Ellen Terwilliger, and good morning and welcome to the Chippewa Valley Book Festival's talk with Dr. Doug Tallamy. He'll be discussing his book, Nature's Best Hope, and if you haven't already turned off your cell phone, please do so now, or at least silence it. Thanks for coming today, and thanks to the many individuals, businesses, public and private organizations that have donated funds and service to make this festival possible. Please check them out in the festival newspaper. We also invite you to help with next year's festival by contributing to the donation jar at the book sale table just outside the hall. At the end of Dr. Tallamy's talk, we all will need to leave this room so the next speaker can set up. If you're attending the next talk, feel free to leave your coat or belongings on your chair. A bit about myself. I came to gardening with a background in art. I looked at plants through that lens: colors, shapes, textures, lines, insects, and the relationship to plants. I never gave it a thought. I started my gardening actually transplanting Creeping Charlie because I liked the purple flowers and I thought it made a great ground cover. A row of marigolds seemed really cheerful. As time went on and I went through my master gardener training, I learned more about pollinators and native plants and that I should include those in my garden. While I've never used herbicides and pesticides and kept reducing my lawn, I did not really understand that all my introduced or non-native plants, like my lovely hosta collection, my lilies, did nothing to help the insect population. Yes, they fed all my deer and bunnies, but not anything else. So Nature's Best Hope pulled together all the pieces on why bringing back natives to our yards and reducing our lawns is one of the best things I can do to slow the decline of insect and bird populations. The book gave me concrete things to do. In a world where it's easy to despair, Dr. Tallamy's book offered me an encouraging message with easy to understand steps that I can take. Those steps are outlined in the homegrown National Park flyer that is available on the back table. Dr. Douglas Tallamy is a professor in the Department of Entomology and Wildlife Ecology at the University of Delaware. I think he has written enough articles and received so many awards that soon that number will equal the number of insect species an oak tree supports. In his book, Bringing Nature Home, The Living Landscape, The Nature of Oaks, The Young Adult and Adult Version of Nature's Best Hope, Doug Tallamy provides us each with the knowledge and steps to take to begin to reverse environmental damage. Dr. Tallamy helps us understand insects and their connections to the health of birds, wildlife, and each of us. Please join me in welcoming Doug Tallamy.
Well, that great introduction. Thank you, Ellen. She covered it. Any questions? Here we go. All right, Nature's Best Hope. I'm going to give you my idea of what Nature's Best Hope is, but I'll give you a spoiler first. You're Nature's Best Hope. So I'm really going to tell you why I think so. But before we do that, let's talk about what E.O. Wilson's idea of Nature's Best Hope was. He, of course, a very famous professor at Harvard. He died 2 years ago, the day after Christmas. Terrible loss to the world of conservation. And one of the things that was consistent throughout his very long career was his love of life on Earth, his love of biodiversity, and his efforts to save it. He wanted to save it not just because he loved it, but because he knew it was essential to our own survival. So in 2016, he wrote this book, Half Earth, Our Planet's Fight for Life, and he had one simple message, one very important message. If we're going to save life anywhere on planet Earth, we're going to have to save nature. We're going to have to save functioning ecosystems on at least half of the planet. Otherwise, they'll disappear everywhere, and that includes humans. And he spent most of the book talking about the science that supports that very bold statement. And then he ended the book. He didn't spend a lot of time telling us how we were going to save life on half of, or how we were going to save nature on half of planet Earth. Of course, to a conservation biologist, that's a wonderful idea. We'll just put half the Earth aside and everything that's in trouble will be in that half, and we'll be in the other half, and it'll be great. But half of terrestrial Earth is already in some form of agriculture, and we've got 8 billion people in the other half, along with all of our airports and roadways and detritus, and we don't have a third half to put aside for nature. So how can we actually do this? That's really what I want to talk about today. I think we can realize E.O. Wilson's dream, but we need a new approach to conservation to do that. Before we talk about that, though, let's talk about a phenomenon happened in 2019, very large oak mast. And you know what? We're having pretty good oak mast this year, too. Members of the Red Oak group got together and decided to make their acorns at the same time. And that's what it looked like in a lot of places. Well, I'm easily entertained, so I took one of those acorns and I just stared at it. But I was rewarded because the insect started to chew its way out of the acorn. First it chewed a little hole for its head, then it forced its head through there, then it forced its entire body through that hole. It's a tight squeeze. And once it plops down, that's a dangerous time for that insect because it's good to eat. A lot of things are after it. So it gets to safety by wiggling and squirming beneath the soil surface. It takes about 30 seconds. And once it's underground, it stretches in all directions and forms a chamber. And within that chamber, converts itself to a pupa. And then surprisingly, stays in that underground chamber as a pupa for 2 years. After 2 years, comes out as an acorn weevil. That's what an acorn weevil looks like. A lot of people think weevils have big noses because it looks like they do. But that's actually an extension of the head capsule. And the mouth parts are way down there at the end of that extension. They take those mouth parts and chew a hole into the center of the acorn, turn around and lay an egg in that hole, and that is how the larvae gets into the acorn. Why do they spend 2 years underground? Why don't they come out the very next year the way most insects would? Well, it takes red oak acorns 18 months to complete their development. So if they come out the very next year, there wouldn't be enough acorns for them. Of course, after they leave the acorn, it leaves a hole, kind of like a true vacuum, and you know that nature abhors a vacuum. And in this case, she's filled it with three species of temnothorax ants. Tiny little ants where the entire colony lives in the holes made by acorn weevils after they've left the acorns. And if scouts find a new hole in a new acorn, they get all excited because their old acorn's falling apart. So they tell everybody it's time to move, time to grab the larvae, grab the eggs, move the entire colony into the new acorn. That takes about 30 minutes. Then they post a guard, make sure nobody else comes in. And that's where they'll live for the next 2 years until that acorn falls apart. So what's my point with this little story? That's just one of literally millions of very specialized interactions, largely between animals and plants, that comprise the bulk of nature. This is another one, the relationship between jays and acorns. Jays are the primary disperser of oak acorns. They'll take an acorn, they'll fly up to a mile, sometimes a mile and a half from the parent tree. Then they tap the acorn beneath the soil surface. And the object is they're going to go back in the wintertime and have something to eat. But for every four acorns they bury, they only remember where one is. So for every four acorns they bury, they have planted three oak trees, and they can bury up to 4,500 acorns per jay every fall. Specialized interaction between pileated woodpeckers and carpenter ants. That's what they rear their young on, carpenter ants. So you won't have pileated woodpeckers unless you have a lot of carpenter ants, and you won't have a lot of carpenter ants unless you have the big trees that make those carpenter ants. You won't have this bee, Andrena phacelii, unless you have phacelia. That is the only plant, the only pollen that bee can rear its young on. It turns out that pollen specialization is really common in our native bees. We have between 3,600 and 4,000 species of native bees, and over a third of them can only reproduce on the pollen of particular plants. You won't have the Baltimore checker spot unless you have a white turtle head. I could talk all week, all year about nature specialized relationships. The point I want to make this morning, though, is that most of these relationships today are in trouble. As a matter of fact, nature itself is on the ropes. And it's on the ropes because we didn't take Teddy Roosevelt's advice. Way back in 1908, Teddy heard that the state of Arizona was going to mine the Grand Canyon. So he went to the canyon, looked out over the edge, and he said, "Leave it as it is." And with those five words, he started the process of creating the Grand Canyon National Park. Well, we didn't leave most of the country as it was. There's only about 5% of the lower 48 states that's anything close to its original pristine ecological condition, and those are typically mountaintops. And that's because we have logged the country repeatedly. We have drained it. I mean, grazed it. Now we're draining it. We have tilled it. Now we're draining it. Now we're grazing it. We got 770 million acres of rangeland in this country. That's 4.5 times the size of Texas, dedicated to cattle. And of course, we paved it or otherwise developed it. We have straightened our rivers and dammed them. You can spell that any way you want. We polluted our skies and changed our climate for centuries to come. We've drained our aquifers. We've introduced more than 3,300 species of plants from other continents, many of which are running amok in our natural areas. In short, we've carved up those natural areas into tiny remnants their former selves. And each one of those remnants is too small and too isolated to sustain the amount of nature that we humans need. It is nature, it is functioning ecosystems that keep us alive on this planet. So why have we done that? I don't know. But I suspect we thought that our nest, planet Earth, was so large, we could foul it forever and there wouldn't be any consequences. Of course, we were wrong about that, and we're seeing some pretty scary headlines on a regular basis now, like the insect apocalypse is here. What does it mean for the rest of life on Earth? Talking about global insect decline, followed by this one. North America's lost 3 billion breeding birds in the last 50 years. That's a third of our North American bird population already gone. And now the UN says, well, gee, we're going to lose a million species to extinction probably in the next 20 years. And they said it 2 years ago, so I guess that's the next 18 years now. Now, that's a prediction. Hasn't happened yet, and we've got to make sure it doesn't happen because those are the species that keep us alive in this planet. It's not just a headline. So I could go on talking about the pox that we humans have delivered upon the environment, and as Shakespeare says, upon all of our houses. That's not what this talk is about. This talk's about a cure for that pox. It's a cure that'll take small efforts from lots of people, people like you and me, but those efforts will deliver enormous physical, psychological, and environmental benefits to everybody. Let's return briefly to this headline, the insect apocalypse is here. What does it mean for the rest of life on Earth? Well, back to E.O. Wilson. He told us what would happen if Earth lost its insects. And he did it way back in 1987 with this paper, The Little Things That Run the World. And again, his message was very clear. Life as we know it depends on insects. And if they disappeared, lots of nasty things would happen. Most of the flowering plants would also disappear. And if that happened, that would so drastically change energy flow through our terrestrial ecosystems that the food webs that support our animals, our amphibians, our birds, our reptiles, our mammals, those food webs would collapse and all those animals would disappear. By the way, we're mammals. That includes us. The biosphere, the living portion of the Earth, would rot because we would have lost insect decomposers that rapidly turn over nutrients, and all we would have is insects and bacteria and fungi. And again, humans wouldn't survive any of those drastic changes. There is some good news, and that is that none of that has to happen. We can save our insects. We can save our birds. We can save nature itself. But we're going to have to change the way we landscape to do it. Now, there have been visionaries through the ages who have recognized that we humans needed to work on our relationship with planet Earth. And, of course, you know, Aldo Leopold was one of the best, wrote extensively in the first half of the 1900s. And one of the things he said is the oldest task in human history is to live in a piece of land without spoiling it. There have been indigenous groups that have been able to do that for long periods. But our huge Western societies and our huge Asian societies are terrible at doing that. We habitually take more from the earth than it has to offer, completely wrecking an area, going to another area, doing the same thing, not sustainable behavior. But Otto Leopold had a lot of faith in humans. He believed that we were capable of developing what he called a land ethic. He knew we had to use the land. We had to farm and lumber and graze and do all those things. But he believed we could learn to do them gently enough that we did not destroy local ecosystems. That's what he called the land ethic, and he wrote about it in his most famous book, Sand County Almanac. What he did not write about, though, is developing a land ethic where we actually lived. And I'm not sure why that was, but I suspect the notion that humans and nature cannot live together, we cannot coexist in the same place at the same time, that notion was so deeply embedded in the culture of Aldo Leopold's day, not gone, still embedded in our own culture. He may not have recognized it as an option. So what I want to argue this morning is that not only is living with nature an option, it's now the only viable option that's left to us. In the past, of course, conservationists worked pretty much exclusively where there weren't a lot of people. We now need to flip that on its head and practice conservation where there are a lot of people, because that's pretty much everywhere. And that means we've got to find ways for nature to thrive in human-dominated landscapes. Not hang on by a thread, but thrive. Where should we start? Let's start on private property. Most of the country is privately owned. 78% of the entire country is privately owned. 85.6% of the country east of the Mississippi is privately owned. If we don't practice conservation on private property, we're going to fail. And we do have parks, and we do have preserves, and they're doing the best they can. But we are in the sixth great extinction event that the planet has ever experienced, so obviously that's not good enough. The solution now is to practice conservation on properties just like that, outside of parks and preserves. When I use the word conservation, I'm not using it exactly the way I mean. We do want to conserve any bits of nature that are left out there. Absolutely. That has been our conservation model for the last century. And we want to keep doing that. But obviously, it's not enough. So now we have to move into beyond conservation into restoration. We've got to put back much of what we've destroyed. And a lot of people say, well, you're never going to put it back exactly the way it was. And they're right, we're not. But we can reunite enough of those specialized interactions to create functional ecosystems again. And that's what we're going for, ecosystem function. Even if it's not exactly what was on that space at some point in the past. But in order to do that, you have to start with the building blocks. Not all species contribute to ecosystem function equally. So we have to start with the most powerful groups. And there's two groups that we can't do without. One is the flowering plants. And, of course, the pollinators that allow those plants to reproduce. They're capturing energy from the sun and converting it through photosynthesis into simple sugars and carbohydrates, which is the food that supports just about all the animals on the planet. So now that food is tied up in plant parts, mostly leaves. If you don't get that food to animals, you don't have any animals. If you don't have any animals, you don't have a functioning ecosystem. Well, it turns out that most vertebrates don't eat plants directly. Most vertebrates eat something else that ate plants, usually invertebrates, usually insects, and not just any insect. Caterpillars turn out to be enormously important in terrestrial food webs. They are transferring more energy from plants to other animals than any other type of plant eater. So if we design landscapes without caterpillars, then we've got a failed food web and eventually failed ecosystem. Let's use the Carolina chickadee as an example. That's the chickadee that occurs at my house in southeast Pennsylvania. You've got the black-capped chickadee, pretty much the same bird doing the same thing. And one of the things they do is come to our feeders all winter long and eat seeds. So we tend to think that that's all chickadees need is seeds. Actually, only 50% of their diet is seeds, even in the wintertime. The other 50% is insects and spiders, even in the wintertime. And when it comes time to reproduce, baby chickadees can't eat seeds at all. And that is typical for most of the birds that are out there. The babies cannot eat seeds. So they switch to invertebrates, typically insects, and not just any insects. If they're in a healthy environment, they will rear their young exclusively on caterpillars. And they're not alone. 96% of our terrestrial birds rear their young on insects, and most of those insects are caterpillars. So birds need caterpillars. The next question is, how many caterpillars do they need? That's a good question. Is one or two enough, or one or two a day enough? Well, let's go back to Carolina chickadees. There's a lot of data on Carolina chickadees. How many caterpillars does it take to make a nest of Carolina chickadees? One or two is not enough. One or two a day is not enough. It takes thousands, 6,000 to 9,000 caterpillars, depending on the number of chicks in the nest, to get one nest of Carolina chickadee to the point where they leave the nest. And after they leave the nest, the parents continue to feed them caterpillars for another 21 days. So you're really talking about tens of thousands of caterpillars required to make one nest of a bird that's a third of an ounce. That's 4 pennies worth of bird. And if you want chickadees to breed in your yard, you've got to have all those caterpillars in your yard because they only forage about 50 meters from the nest. They're not flying 5 miles down the road to the nearest woodlot. And that's true for most of the birds out there. You don't want to spend more energy getting food than you get from the food. And if we landscape in a way that does not include all of those caterpillars, that's called insect decline. And it's really looking like insect decline is one of the major causes of the bird declines that we're measuring out there. We went to the original data set of Rosenberg and all. That's the Smithsonian group that said we've lost 3 billion birds in the last 50 years and divided the terrestrial bird species into two groups. The species that require insects, typically when they're breeding, and the species that do not require insects when they're breeding. So things like doves and finches and crossbills, they make a little milk out of seeds, and that's what they rear their young on. They don't need insects. And look, they didn't decline at all in the last 50 years. But the birds that require insects decline on average 10 million individuals per species. It doesn't prove cause and effect, but it does suggest as you take bird food away, you lose the birds. So we need to raise the bar about what we're asking our landscapes to do. In the past, we've asked them to do one thing, be pretty. Now we're going to ask them to do two things, be pretty and ecologically functional at the same time. That is our current challenge. And of course, they're not going to be ecologically functional unless we put those caterpillars back. So how do you do that? How do you add caterpillars to your local landscape? You do it by putting the plants that support those caterpillars into that landscape, which seems pretty easy, but there is a catch, and that is that most plants don't support a lot of caterpillars. So we have to be fussy about it. We've got to choose the plants that do, and we have to be fussy about it because the caterpillars themselves are fussy about it. And the monarch butterfly illustrates that perfectly. You can have all of the crepe myrtle and all the buckthorn and all the burning bush and all the barberry and all the castas and all the ginkgos and all the things that we typically landscape with, plants from other continents in our yards, and you won't make a single monarch butterfly. The only thing that's going to make a monarch butterfly is one of the milkweeds. That's called host plant specialization, and most of the insects that eat plants are host plant specialists. They can only eat particular plants. Why is that? Well, plants don't want to be eaten. They want to capture the energy from the sun and use it for their own growth and reproduction, so they've loaded their leaves with nasty-tasting chemicals, secondary metabolic compounds that make those leaves either bitter or downright toxic. And it's a really effective defense. It keeps most of the insects of the world from eating most of the plants of the world, which is why it's green out there in the summertime. It's not because there's no insects out there that want to eat those plants. It's because most of the insects that are out there cannot eat most of the plants. And if you don't believe me, when you're leaving, eat a plant. See if you like it. You're not going to like it. There's a reason it's hard to get our kids to eat their vegetables. They inherently know they're toxic. But we do know that insects eat plants. So how do they do that? How do they get around those chemical defenses? Well, this is where the specialization comes in. 90% of the insects that eat plants are host plant specialists. They can only eat the plants for which they have very specialized adaptations. Specialized enzymes that store and excrete and detoxify those compounds. Behavioral adaptations and life history adaptations that minimize the insect's exposure to those compounds. It takes a long period of interacting with those plant lineages for all of those adaptations to fall into place. And I'm talking about long. We're talking about many thousands of years, which is why when we bring in a plant from another continent, our insects typically can't eat it. It hasn't been around nearly long enough for them to evolve those interactions. And once they do evolve the adaptations to get around those defenses, they're locked into eating that particular plant lineage because they focused on that over evolutionary time, not on something else. So if you take out the milkweeds from your yard and replace it with hostas, the monarch's not going to start to make a living on your hostas. It's locked into eating milkweeds, which means it has two choices: fly away and find milkweed someplace else, or starve to death. So all I'm trying to say here is that plant choice matters. If we're going to rebuild ecosystem function, if we're going to rebuild ecosystems themselves, we can't do it without having functional food webs in them, and that's not going to happen unless we choose the plants that make them functional. And I'm going to give you three examples of how well this works when we do choose the right plants, starting with my house right here in Oxford, Pennsylvania. My wife wants me to call it our house, but I don't know why. She does live there, too. We moved there in the year 2000. It was a farm that was broken up into 10-acre lots, and very old farm, but farmed almost 300 years. Soil was exhausted. The last thing they did was mow it for hay. So there wasn't much there, believe me. And our job, of course, was to put it back together again. But we'd never done that before. You know, we knew we wanted to, but we never did. One thing I did know is that I like caterpillars, and I wanted to see if we could get some to make a living at our house. And the first thing I tried was the Canadian owlet. I'd never even seen a Canadian owlet. That's what a Canadian owlet looks like. People say, why'd you choose a Canadian owlet? Well, I looked through Dave Wagner's Caterpillars of Eastern North America, and I said, that's a pretty one. So it was very scientific. That's what the adult looks like, just like a leaf. Well, you're not going to have Canadian owlets unless you have their host plant, meadow rue. We didn't have any meadow rue. I'm sure meadow rue grew there 300 years ago before the place was farmed to death, but no meadow rue. So I got some meadow rue seeds from someplace and planted them, and they grew very nicely. But this was early on, and I actually had very little faith that Canadian owlets would appear out of nowhere and find my meadow rue. So I didn't even go out and check it for about 2 months after I planted it. Then I walked by for another reason, and I looked over. It was covered with Canadian owlets. They had found it right away. I'm still impressed with that. So now we have a good population of Canadian owlets and meadow rue. So we've added two species to the property. The restoration has begun. Same story with the goldenrod stowaway. That's actually a misnomer. That beautiful moth has nothing to do with goldenrod. It's a specialist on that plant, Biden's Aristosa. We didn't have any Biden's Aristosa, ditch daisy. But I did know where there was some Biden's in a power line cut about 14 miles away. So I got some seeds, planted them at home. They grew very nicely. As a matter of fact, I took over my front yard last year. It's okay. I had to wait a year for the goldenrod stowaway to find my patch of Biden's, but they did. And now we have a good population of both of those. So we've added four species to the property. Wanted to see if I get the hackberry emperor to make a living at our house. Not because it's the most beautiful butterfly in the world, but because it belongs there. It's one of the species that ought to be on our property. But as its name suggests, it's a specialist on hackberry, on Celtis. We didn't have any hackberry. So I got some hackberry trees, I planted them. I had to wait 4 years for the hackberry emperor to find my hackberry, but they did, and now we got them as well. So now I've added six species to the property, and that's how the restoration proceeded. I did not plant goldenrod, came in on its own, and along with it came many of the things that require goldenrod, like the beautiful brown-hooded owlet, the Arcidura flower moth, the goldenrod leaf miner, the distinct Sparaginothus, the goldenrod gall moth. There are 110 species of caterpillars that use goldenrod in the mid-Atlantic states where we live. I planted Virginia creeper. Yes, Virginia creeper. I hear some people don't like it, but I don't know why. Look, it's got good fall color. It can climb our trees without girdling them, without pulling them down. It's a good ground cover. It makes valuable berries for the birds in the fall. And by valuable, I mean they're high in fat. Our migrating birds are looking for sources of fat. That's what fuels the migration. So berries that are low in fat don't help. Berries that are high in fat do. And those berries came from tiny little inconspicuous flowers. You don't even know Virginia creeper's in bloom until you see this big cloud of native bees around it. It's a wonderful pollinator plant. Remember, when you're making a pollinator garden, you're making it for the pollinators. If it's not big and showy for you, that's okay. I planted Virginia creeper because it's the best host plant for the large sphinx moth caterpillars that are a primary component of cardinal diets. Things like the Pandora sphinx and its beautiful adult, the leonard sphinx, the hog sphinx, the abbot sphinx, all on Virginia creeper. American elm, we'll get rid of that one. I had to really shorten this talk, so... I want to see if I can get evening primrose moth in our house because it's beautiful. I like beauty like anybody else. Well, believe it or not, evening primrose moth requires evening primrose, and we didn't have any. We didn't have much of anything. So I planted evening primrose. The moth came, spends the day with its head stuffed in the flowers. Sometimes it's crowded in there, but it's always cute. And I planted lots of oaks. Now, these are just examples of the plants that we put back on our property, but I want to focus on oaks for a while because they are such important plants. That's the Bedford oak in Bedford, New York, Martha Stewart land. People argue about whether it's 400 years old or 500 years old. It's enormous. And I hear people say, I'm not going to plant an oak because I won't live long enough to enjoy it. And if you can only enjoy your oak when it's 400 years old, you're right. You won't. But if you can enjoy what your oak is contributing to your local food web, and remember that's a new goal, you can enjoy it right away. And I can say that with confidence because I planted most of my oaks as acorns, which means they were free, or 2-foot bare root whips, which means they cost $1.50 each. And immediately they started to call in the moths that create the caterpillars that run the food web at our house. Things like the solitary oak leaf miner, juvenile's dusky wing, the yellow-shouldered moth, Suzuki's promolactus, the red-washed caterpillar, the yellow-vested moth, the orange-tufted oneida, the spiny oak caterpillar, the two-spotted oak punky, the variable oak leaf caterpillar, the red-humped oak worm, the pink-striped oak worm, the hesitant dagger moth, the medium dagger moth, the lesser oak dagger moth, the greater oak dagger moth, the streaked dagger moth, the afflicted dagger moth, the crown bugolatrix, the orange patch smoky wing, the white-blotched heterocampa, the oblique heterocampa, the red-lined panapota, the laffer, and literally hundreds more species of moths. You should clap for those oaks because they're the best plants. Look, they come right away. This is the pin oak that's just popped its head above the leaves, and there's a caterpillar standing on the ground eating the leaves of that tree. People say, oh, it's going to kill the tree. No, an oven bird's going to come eat that caterpillar in the next 10 minutes. You don't have to wait decades or hundreds of years for your oak to start to contribute to your local food web. Happen right away. That's what our house looks like these days, taken from about the same place I took that first picture. Just to give you an idea, we put some plants back. Now, my research has shown that if you know the number of species of moths in your local food web, Moths, not butterflies. Butterflies are day-flying, bad-tasting moths. And because they're bad-tasting, they're not important parts of local food webs. But the moths are. So if you know the number of species of moths in your food web, you have a very good index of the productivity of that food web. In other words, how many species is that food web supporting? And the stability of that food web. So for the last 6 years, I've been counting the number of species of moths that I find at our house. Take a picture of it. I've got to have a picture of it for it to count. And I'm still at it, but I'm up to 1,200. I got three more species since I submitted this talk. So now it's 1,254 species of moths so far are making a living on our property because we put the plants back. Now we've got 10 acres. Pennsylvania's 2.4 million acres. So on 1/240,000th of the land mass, we've got 48% of all the moths that occur in the entire state. And because so many of these are types of bird food, we have recorded 62 species of birds that have bred on our 10 acres. Not flew by. You got to make more birds or it doesn't count. But bred. So why am I telling you this? This is another headline we see all the time. The World Wildlife Fund says Earth has lost 2/3 of its wildlife since 1970. It's a terrible statistic. I'm thinking, gee, not at our house. I am convinced we have increased biodiversity by more than 2/3. It didn't take that long, and it wasn't that hard. We just put the plants back. What would happen if everybody put the plants back? We really could turn a lot of these headlines around. Four things we need to talk about if we're going to succeed in a big way, and we need to succeed in a big way, and one of them is to talk about those big lawns that we have out there. Latest figure I've seen is 44 million acres of lawn. An area bigger than all of New England, dedicated to an ecological deadscape. So why do we do that? Well, it's a status symbol. It's a very old status symbol of wealth, so we all want to display our wealth, and we have to display our Halloween decorations. But what if we cut the area of lawn in half? Notice I'm not saying get rid of lawn. We're going to cut the area of lawn in half. What if we take spaces like that and turn it into that? I got this picture from Dan Getman. I've never met Dan, but he had this big lawn. He lives in Missouri, and he said, look, I'm doing it. I'm putting plants back. I said, okay, I'll put it in my talk. Let's make the math simple. So we've got 40 million acres of lawn. We're going to cut that in half. That'll give us 20 million acres that we can restore right at home, which will be enough area to create what I am calling Homegrown National Park, and you can learn more about it from that brochure that's back there. It's big. It's bigger than the Adirondacks, plus Yellowstone, plus Yosemite, Grand Tetons, Canyonlands, Mount Rainier, North Cascades, Badlands National Park, Olympics National Park, Sequoia National Park, plus the Grand Canyon, plus Denali, which is huge, plus the Great Smoky Mountains. You add up all those parks, still less than 20 million acres. So Homegrown National Park is going to be the biggest park in the country. So we're going to shrink the lawn. We're going to join Homegrown National Park. It's free, by the way. That's good. What plants should we put in the area that we take out of lawn? I'm going to argue that some of them have to be what I'm calling keystone plants. Remember what a keystone is. It's a stone in the middle of the Roman arch. If you take that stone out of the arch collapses. Well, if you take keystone plants out of your local food web, the food web collapses because they are making most of the food. Just 14% of our native plants are making 90% of the caterpillar food that drives those food webs. So think of the keystone plants in the ecological house that you're building as the 2x4s that hold that house up. They're the support system. You cannot build a house out of wallpaper, and that's what we've been trying to do for the last century. What's the best keystone plant? Well, in 84% of the counties in which it occurs, it's one of the oaks. We've got 91 species of oaks in this country, a big genus. In the mid-Atlantic states, they support 557 species of caterpillars. And compare that to tulip trees, another good native plant, but it only supports 21 species. So huge differences among our native plants. Over 950 species nationwide. There's no other plant genus that comes close to that. If you want to know what the best plants are where you live, go to Native Plant Finder on the National Wildlife Federation website. Put in your zip code and the ranked list of the top woody plants and herbaceous plants in your county will pop up. These are, you know, this is just an example, and the list is much bigger than I just ran out of room. But the old excuse of I don't know what the best plants are, Yes, you do. Go to Native Plant Finder. It's right there. Okay, we're going to shrink the lawn. We're going to use keystone plants. We're going to invite a lot of insects to our yard. And then we're going to kill them with our security light, which is not the goal. Turns out that light pollution is a major cause of insect declines. And these are all the ways that light is killing our insects. But you know what? It's good news to me. We have got to reverse, not just stop, but reverse insect decline. We've already lost more than 45% of the insects on the planet. And they are the little things that run the world. If we can turn that around by flicking a switch, we're getting off easy. There are a lot of switches to flick, but there's a lot of us to flick the switches, right? But I know what a lot of people say. Well, gee, I can't turn the light out over my barn, or I can't turn it out over my garage, or I can't turn it out over my front porch because the bad man will come. Okay, put a motion sensor on it. So it only turns on when the bad man does come. And the first thing you notice is the bad man doesn't come very often. Even easier is to take the white bulb out of your security light and put in a yellow bulb. Yellow LED, yellow incandescent, it doesn't matter. It's yellow wavelengths that are far less attractive to nocturnal insects, particularly those moths, than white or blue wavelengths. If we switched out our white bulbs for yellow bulbs overnight, we could save millions of insects. And if we use LEDs, we could save millions of dollars too. So we're going to shrink the lawn. We're going to use keystone plants. We're going to modify our light system. Then we're going to invite one of the mosquito foggers to come kill all our insects. Booming business around the country, really booming business. And they say, well, it's okay, because what we're fogging is a natural product. And it is. It's pyrethroids, which is an insecticide made by chrysanthemums to kill insects. It's industrial strength insecticide, but being natural, that doesn't mean anything to me. Cyanide is natural. Ricin is natural. There's some really nasty compounds that nature makes out there. So that's not convincing to me. They also say it only kills mosquitoes. Not so. It kills all of the insects it comes in contact with, including all the pollinators we're working so hard to save, including the monarch, which is now red-listed, not by the U.S., but by the IUCN, you know what I mean. Well, we've lost 97% of our monarchs since 1976. That's the result of the mosquito fogging event on the eastern shore of Maryland, and it's happening all over the country. The interesting thing is, or the ironic thing is, mosquito fogging does not control mosquitoes. So we're doing this for nothing. You don't control mosquitoes in the adult stage. It's too hard. You've got to kill 90% of the adults to get good control. These guys kill between 10 and 50%. So they're not even close to getting good control. If you really want to control mosquitoes, you do it in the larval stage. Get a bucket, fill it full of water, put in a handful of straw or hay, put it out in the sun for a couple of days, and let the population of diatoms and algae build up in that bucket. That's what mosquito larvae eat. Diatoms and algae. And once that happens, it will become an irresistible brew to the local mosquitoes in your yard. The females will want to lay their eggs preferentially in your bucket so that their larvae can eat all of those algae and diatoms. Then you go to the hardware store and you buy a sheet of mosquito dunks, $12 for a whole season's worth of control. That is Bacillus thuringiensis. It is a natural bacterium that only kills aquatic diptera. And the only aquatic diptera in your bucket is a mosquito larva. It's extremely targeted, so if a dragonfly gets in there or some other insect, won't hurt it a bit. If your dog drinks it, won't hurt it. You might put a coarse screen over it so that the chipmunk doesn't commit suicide. But it's targeted, it's cheap, it works, particularly if everybody did it. And you don't kill anything else. Okay, the fourth thing we need to do is to landscape in a way that allows those caterpillars to complete their development, particularly under our trees. We're just starting to think about this, but this is an example. I live in Chester County, Pennsylvania, where oaks support 511 species of caterpillars. A few of them, like the Polyphemus moth, complete their development on the tree. Caterpillar eats the leaves, then it spins a cocoon and hangs from one of the branches, then it emerges as an adult, then it does it all over again. Everything happens on the tree, but that's unusual. Most of the caterpillars on that tree will drop from the tree after they finish growing and wiggle their way underneath the ground and pupate underground, or they spin a cocoon in the leaf litter that's under that tree. And that's the problem. There is no leaf litter under the tree. We don't tolerate it. It's messy. And we mow and compact the area around our trees. Usually the grass goes right up to the tree, making the soil rock hard, particularly in the summertime, so it's too hard for those caterpillars to get down there. These are oak trees. That makes it a ecological trap. It's calling in the moths. They lay their eggs in the tree. The caterpillars develop and drop down and die because of the way we are landscaping under our trees. And the cement landscape is not the answer either. I am convinced that the way we landscape under our trees is another major cause of insect declines around the country. And this is what most people do. You got a tree in your yard and you've got your grass. I've got a new grad student this year who's measuring how well caterpillars do in a situation like that, but I guarantee they're going to do better in a layered landscape where you have a tree and then maybe a dogwood or an azalea, native ferns and ground cover. Soft landing. Caterpillar falls down. The ground is not compacted under there. Nobody's going to mow it. Nobody's going to step on it. Be much higher survivorship. This is where you can do your fancy spring ephemeral gardening. Put beds around your trees. This is how you shrink the lawn. Put beds under your trees. Every bit of bed you have there is less lawn. The bigger, the better. Your trees will love it, and so will the caterpillars. Use native ground covers liberally. Things like wild ginger, native pachysandra. What's that? Virginia. There's the Virginia creeper being a good ground cover. Golden seal, May apples, foam flower, ferns. Come back here. If you can see the ground, you don't have enough plants out there. Green mulch is the way to go. Again, the tree will love it, and it'll give those caterpillars a wonderful place to complete their development. Okay, a former grad student, Desiree Narango, did some wonderful work with chickadees in the suburbs of Washington, D.C., and her results suggest there's actually room for compromise in our plant choices, and that's a good news. She had one simple question. How well do chickadees do in a suburban landscape that's dominated by native plants versus suburban landscapes dominated by non-native ornamentals? And when they're dominated by non-native ornamentals, they produce 75% fewer caterpillars. So right away, you've reduced the amount of bird food by 75%. They were 60% less likely to have breeding chickadees at all. Everybody had a nest box up in their landscapes. But the chickadees would come and look around and say, there's not enough food here. We're not even going to try to reproduce. If they did try to reproduce, they laid 1.5 fewer eggs. Those clutches were 29% less likely to survive at all. If they did survive, they produced 1.2 fewer fledglings, and it took them 1.5 days longer to do that. And if you put all that into a population growth model, as a function of the percentage of non-native woody plant biomass, from none to 100% in your yard, this is what you get. We looked at woody plants because that's where chickadees forage, on woody plants. This dotted line is replacement rate. That's the rate at which the population has to make babies to replace the adults that die every year. If you reproduce at that rate, you have a sustainable population. It's not growing, but it's not shrinking either. If you make more babies than adults die, the blue stuff above the line there, you have a growing population. But if you make fewer babies than adults die, and that's what's happening out here when you have a large percentage of non-native plants, then you have an unsustainable shrinking population. Right here is where those lines intersect, which suggests, very liberally speaking, you can have up to 30% of your woody plant biomass non-native without destroying the local food web. The chickadees will still be able to reproduce. Now, we can't tolerate any, so that's our area of compromise. But we can't tolerate any invasive plants because they're ecological tumors. They just keep growing, they escape, and they castrate local ecosystem function. But there are a lot of ornamentals that are not invasive. Remember Dengetman? That's a ginkgo tree. Did you catch that the first time? Why does Dan have a ginkgo in his native planting for? Because Dan's wife likes ginkgos, and she said, Dan, I want a ginkgo. So he put a ginkgo in. Is that plant destroying the functionality of this native planting? No. It's just there. Is it going to escape and become an invasive species in the woodlot? No. It's just there. So I like to think of plants that are just there. They're not contributing. They're just there, as if they're statues. So there you go. There's Dan's statue. Now, if everything that Dan put in his yard was a statue, he would not have a functional food web. It's not the presence of non-native plants that destroys local food webs. It's the absence of those contributing native plants. So if we increase the percentage of those contributors, we can tolerate a lot of these. Can we use native plants formally? Certainly we can. This is a Lynn O'Shaughnessy design. You don't get more formal than that. Every plant in that landscape is a native plant. It was taken by a drone 400 feet up. Formality is a function of the design. It's not a function of the plants in the design. Our native plants are used in formal designs in Europe every day. They love them over there, where they're non-native plants. Can we get a pollinator garden into a suburban yard like this without offending anybody? Sure we can. Put a little fence around it. It formalizes it. It tells your neighbor it's not just a bunch of weeds you forgot to mow. It's pretty when it's in bloom. It's servicing several species of bees. It's not very big. It could be bigger. But if everybody did it, it would help a lot. Help what? Help make pollinators. Why do we need pollinators? Well, the media will tell you because they pollinate a third of our crops. No, they pollinate about a 12th of our crops. And I hear people say, I'm not going to plant for pollinators because I don't live next to an ag field. So I don't need them. Yes, you do. Forget the ag argument for pollinators. We need pollinators. Really, pollinators are bigger than us. It's more than just us. We need them because they pollinate 80% of all plants and 90% of all flowering plants. If we lost our pollinators, we'd lose 80 to 90% of the plants on the planet, and that's not an option. Where do we need pollinators? Every place we need plants, which is every place. How about this? Drew Latham design, much bigger. Imagine the amount of life here versus the amount of life there. Seems like a no-brainer. Can municipalities help us live with nature? Yes, they can, and Minnesota's been doing it for a while. They've got a cost-sharing program that pays homeowners to reduce or eliminate their lawn and replace it with appropriate Minnesota prairie plants. Very, very popular. Pennsylvania has a similar program now. It's not funded very well, so there's a big, long waiting list. There's an island off of Florida, I think it's Marco Island, that is paying homeowners to allow burrowing owls, listed species, to burrow in the front yard. This is the way the Endangered Species Act should have been written, with carrots rather than sticks. If you have an endangered species on your property, we're going to pay you to take care of it rather than fine you if you use your property. Everybody would want an endangered species. Put a bounty on the invasive ornamentals like calorie pear. That's what St. Louis, Missouri did, Fayetteville, Arkansas. North Carolina has a bounty on it. If you take out a calorie pear, you get a free tree replacement. Public utilities are giving people $100 coupons to plant water-efficient native plants. And, of course, the big lawn reduction programs in the far west, particularly California, that's going up. Now you get $3 rebate for every square foot of lawn that you replace with a xeric planting. It's incentives. You know, you're incentivizing people to do the right thing. And if you want more information on all those programs, memorize that. All right, we've made three missteps, I think. We've made three missteps in the early years of conservation. And the first one's important. We're starting to think of nature as if it's optional. We like it. We like to ride our bikes there or go bird watching or just observe the natural things. But it's not essential. And if it's not essential, when push comes to shove, when resources are in short supply, nature takes a back seat. And resources are always in short supply. I went to the Cincinnati Zoo before the virus broke out, and there's this wall-sized poster there, which to me epitomizes our society's view of conservation. We want to save nature, we want to save wildlife so that future generations can enjoy it. That was Teddy Roosevelt's argument for expanding the national park system. We want to save these beautiful places so that future generations can enjoy it. And I get that because nature is enormously entertaining, but it is much more than that. We want to save nature so that we have future generations. It's a little bit more urgent. We've also assumed that humans and nature cannot coexist. Now, we talked about that. But if we restrict our conservation efforts just to areas where there's not a lot of humans, we're going to fail because those areas are too few, too small, and too isolated. David Quammen has a great analogy between a Persian rug and an ecosystem. That is a functional Persian rug. That's not 71 Persian rugs. That's 71 rug fragments, none of which are acting like a Persian rug. And that's what we've done to our ecosystems. The UN designates biosphere reserves as places of ecological significance. And I don't like that language because it suggests there are places without ecological significance. Not so. Every square inch of the planet has ecological significance, including our yards, including our corporate landscapes, including our roadsides, including much of our agriculture. So we've got to glue our rug back together again, folks. We've got to put the plants back. Not just to make biological corridors that allow plants and animals to move back and forth between viable habitats, but to recreate viable habitats in all the areas where we've destroyed them. The good news is this is starting to happen. It's starting to happen. And when it does, it'll be the first time in modern human history where we have coexisted with the natural world. Our third misstep was to leave Earth stewardship to just a few specialists, a few conservation biologists, a few ecologists. For some reason, we didn't see it as an inherent responsibility of everybody on the planet. But I don't know why, since every single person on the planet is totally dependent on the quality of their local ecosystems. So why wouldn't everybody share in the responsibility of taking care of those ecosystems? Stan Rushworth, a Cherokee elder, once said, "The Western settler mindset was, I have rights. Mindset of indigenous people is, I have obligations." You're not born with those mindsets, you're taught them. We're very good at teaching this one. We've been terrible at teaching our kids and our peers that we all have obligations to good earth stewardship. That does not mean you have to save biodiversity for a living, but you can save it where you live. And if you do, it empowers you. More and more people are concerned about the state of the planet, but they all feel powerless. What can one person do? Well, one person can shrink the lawn, one person can put in a pollinator garden, one person can remove their invasive plants, we didn't even talk about that, one person can fire Mosquito Joe, one person can shrink the lawn, one person can turn out their lights, one person can do a whole bunch of things to revitalize the little ecosystem on their property and then enhance their greater local ecosystem. And it shrinks the problem down to something that's manageable. Don't worry about the entire planet. You'll get depressed. Just think about the piece of the earth that you can influence. If you own property, it's obvious. That's where you start. If you don't own property, help somebody who does. Help a land conservancy. Help a park or preserve. They're all underfunded. They're all understaffed. They will love you as a volunteer. So as a property owner or a volunteer, each one of us has the power and we certainly have the responsibility to fix dead landscapes like this. Whether or not we do so is going to determine nature's fate and then ultimately our own. So I think I've convinced my grandkids that you are nature's best hope. Hope I've convinced you as well. Thanks very much.
Thank you so much, Doug. We do have time for some questions, so we'll get started right away. Yep. First one up over here.
Who gets to choose? You're choosing?
I'll choose, okay. Unless you want to. I'll defer to Doug.
Thank you, Doug, for coming to Eau Claire, Wisconsin. The city of Eau Claire is pretty progressive. They have a bunch of native plantings down by the parks. If you were to suggest one thing for our municipality to do that would be the most effective for the concept, what would that be?
I haven't noticed a lot of oaks in Eau Claire. I would increase the percentage of them, but I'm going to suggest more than one thing. Changing the lights is really easy, and it's not very expensive. So wherever you can in public buildings or encourage people, that could be a citywide campaign. It's the easiest thing to do, and it really would make a difference. But we've got to increase the percentage of those keystone plants. This used to be a bur oak savanna, essentially, and we got to put some back. Think about it in new developments before we take down big cottonwoods. If you think of each one of the big existing trees there now as if it's $100 million, you're not going to take it down. Otherwise, you have to pay $100 million. That would allow us to figure out ways to develop without sacrificing all these things that have been there 150 years. Because they're really important. So those are all things that we can think about in terms of future development. I know Eau Claire's not going to stop growing. No place is stopping to grow. But we've got to learn how to grow in an ecologically sustainable way.
Take one from this side.
Yes, I would like you to talk a little bit about invasives. Buckthorn is a huge problem here.
Yes, it is. You know, it's so much easier to control invasives before we bring them in. Stop selling them in our nursery. I'm sure you're not selling buckthorns in your nursery anymore, I think. But there are a bunch of invasives you are selling that, you know, most states are still selling English ivy and a whole bunch of things. Porcelain berry, terrible invasives. We don't have buckthorn at our house, but we've got autumn olive. That's still sold in Ohio. So that's number one. It's ridiculous to try to control invasives when you're selling them at your nursery and pretending that they're good plants. So the ban of invasives is a no-brainer. Controlling invasives is a two-step process. One of the reasons buckthorn is so invasive is that the deer don't like it. They don't eat it. We've got overabundance of deer everywhere. They eat all the natives. They leave the buckthorn, so you end up with nothing but buckthorn. Buckthorn's not a super plant. When you fence out deer and you have a little competition between invasives and native plants, the native plants do quite well. It's the deer that tip the competitive advantage towards the invasives that they don't like. So we've got to control our deer for lots of reasons, but that's a big one. You know what? I've got Japanese stilt grass. It's an annual. It's everywhere. I have no idea how to control it. I wish I could replace Japanese stilt grass with buckthorn because I know how to control that. You saw it off at the base, or you get out your whacker. You know, use the mattock. Whack, whack at the roots, poof, out it comes. So I don't have a silver, but it takes a lot of labor. The easiest thing is to you got to be vigilant. Once you get rid of the big guys, our 10 acres were covered with invasives. When you stop mowing, that's what comes back. And my little skinny wife, Cindy, cleared most of it. But she's still out there because the little guys come in every year and you've got to be vigilant there. But it's now a functional ecosystem because you can control the little guys. Again, you get a little hand mattock. Whack, whack. There you go. I know that's a bad answer. Where are we? Did she leave?
Super message today. Thank you so much.
You.
As I sit kind of in the back here, I see a lot of sort of gray hair, thinning hair, an audience that...
Mine's blonde,
yeah,
by the
exactly.
way.
How do you get this message to the young people who are actually going to be the ones that influence us in the future?
All right, I've got two things to say about that. First of all, this book, Nature's Best Hope, has been rewritten as for young readers' version for specifically that region, trying to get it into schools, actually, as part of the curriculum. But we cannot wait another generation before we act. I do talk to mostly baby boomers, and that's not a bad thing. Baby boomers are retired, they have the money, and they've got the property, and they're looking for something to do. They can be a huge force here. So very powerful group. Yes, we've got to get the message to the younger folks, too, but the 5-year-olds and the 10-year-olds, they're not managing property right now. We are, and right now is when we need to do it.
Can you give us 30 seconds on the effects of bacterial decomposition versus insect decomposition?
Well, insect decomposition is a whole lot faster, for one thing. It turns over nutrients really quickly. I mean, if you control your deer, watch how fast that carcass disappears once the blowflies and then a whole sequence of decomposers turn that into nutrients that then seep into the soil or becomes part of the local food web. Bacteria and fungi do it too, but much at a much slower rate. So that's what I would say. It's just a speed thing.
My question for you is, as someone who's going to be stuck consistently renting for a few years here and is not going to be able to afford buying a house, what would you recommend that I do with my space to reverse my impact?
You know, this landscape under the trees thing is a big deal. It's going to make a lot of difference. So I would look at are you in an apartment or a house? They probably have trees on the property. Get permission. Say, I'm going to own this tree, and I'm going to put a bed under it, and I'm going to take care of it. I'm going to keep the leaves there. I'm going to put in the ground cover. You don't have to do a thing. And keep the mowers away from the trees. And you've all of a sudden turned that tree, especially if it's a good tree, into a really productive space. Otherwise, you've got grass right up to it. So that's, you know, do that. Maybe you have the energy to adopt all the trees. I don't know. So, yeah.
All right, we've got time for one more question here.
Oh,
Okay, all right. Sorry. I stepped out. I didn't know.
Great. Awesome. So recently in Eau Claire, we've had a devastating event with our green ash. They've just been destroyed by the emerald ash borer. But also, I know oak wilt is a problem. I would like to plant some oak, but I am concerned about oak wilt. Could you comment on that?
The future of oaks is in your hands. Why do I say that? Because all of, we've got oak wilt, we've got bacterial leaf scorch, we've got sudden oak death syndrome farther out west. We brought in all these diseases, and they're clobbering our oaks, but they're not eliminating them. There is resistance in all the oak populations to all of these diseases. We need to favor that resistance. How are we going to do that? We got to discover the resistant trees. You only do that by planting more oaks, not fewer. So when your local forester says, don't plant oaks anymore, we can't afford to lose oaks. Plant twice as many oaks, and some are going to die. That's right, but the ones that don't are the future. That goes for ash. There is some resistance in ash, not much. And we're making advances with biological control for ash. But the beech blight, all of these things that are clobbering our forest trees, there is resistance, and we've got to favor that. So, all right, thank you very much.
All right, let's give Doug one more big hand. And we're going to let him, I can take that for you. We're going to let Doug get out of this room and over to the signing area. So I'll ask you all to stay seated for just a moment so that he can make his escape and be ready to sign books. And then just a quick reminder, you will need to exit this room even if you are registered for the next one. You can leave your belongings if you'd like to save your chair. The next event is Scott Spoolman, and he will be talking about wonderful Wisconsin features. So if you like this